Good evening. Open almost any astronomical book, and you will see magnificent photographs of planets, stars, nebulae, and so on. But what can one do from oneself in the photographic line? And I've had many letters about that over the last years. Well, I don't pretend to be an expert myself, and so I'm delighted to reintroduce somebody who is, Douglas Arnold. First of all, what about some general guidance for the would-be photographer?
Well, I think there's one very important thing to understand from the beginning, so far as this program is concerned, Patrick. If you ask the typical astronomer what sort of telescope he's got, he will say a 6-inch scope. Now, what he means by that is that the aperture of the telescope is 6 inches or 150 millimeters. That is, in essence, a measure of the light-gathering capability of the telescope, of course. If you ask a photographer, and he says he's got a 150-millimeter lens, he's talking about the focal length of that lens, which is basically a measure of the magnification it gives to any sort of an object. So in this program, we'll be talking exclusively in terms of the photographer's understanding, so a 150-millimeter lens will be the focal length of that lens.
Yes, quite so. Now, what basic equipment do you need?
Well, you need a camera which you can, and this is very important, Patrick, hold the shutter open for a length of time, since we will be using time exposures. An SLR or single lens reflex is very, very helpful, but it doesn't have to be that. With a lockable cable release, you fire that time exposure on the shutter, and you would lock it in a very long exposure, and then you release it in due course. The other things you require is as fast a lens as possible, and also a firm tripod. You cannot possibly have a tripod which is too firm. If you have something like a right-angle viewfinder, it makes life a lot easier. Now, in addition to the purely photographic, you should really equip yourself with a red light torch, which is something that, of course, doesn't spoil your light adaptation at night, and a notebook in which to make the notes of all of your exposures, because you'll be doing hopefully a lot of work, and it's on the basis of these notes that you see which of the exposures which are successful, and therefore it's a basis of your experience.
What about films and film speeds?
Well, this is where a revolution has occurred in recent years, Patrick, particularly with colour films, colour transparency films. In the old days, a fast film was a 400 ISO film. Incidentally, we used to talk about ASA speeds, but it's now referred to as ISO. They mean exactly the same thing. A 400 ISO film was just about the fastest you could get. Now, in colour transparency, there are 1,000, 1,600, and you can push them even further. Now, the point about that is that it's brought to the amateur the capability of taking pictures very often which just a few years ago were the province of the professional. A couple of other points about films is that don't underrate the importance of using black and white. And when you are using colour, remember that laboratories aren't used to handling these sorts of pictures with night skies, with little blobs of light. They won't know what it is, and they'll massacre the film when they cut it. So if you want to, ask them to return it unmounted, or if that's a bit too much of a bother, what you should do is to expose a couple of very orthodox daylight view at the beginning so that the laboratory can set its cutters and you don't lose all your hard-won pictures.
Well, that's certainly a very useful tip indeed. Well, next, what to photograph. Personally, I would advise against turning a camera anywhere near the sun because there's a danger to your eyesight. So if you leave the sun out of it, what next?
Well, I think the moon, Patrick, much to your pleasure, I know, because it is a daylit object. It's very much like daylight on Earth, and the exposures which will be used by our starting astrophotographer of perhaps 500th of a second at f11 for a full moon and maybe a 30th of a second at f11 for a crescent moon are well within their sort of borders of knowledge. I think the important thing with the moon to understand is the importance of focal length. Now, there's a rough rule of thumb here in which you can say that for every 100 millimetres of focal length in a lens, you get just 1 millimetre diameter of the moon on the 35 millimetre frame. Now, we can demonstrate this by some pictures. If you're using a 50 mil lens, well, it is almost a spot of light. If you go up to a 200 mil lens, you're beginning to see a bit more. 400, you're really beginning to get into business because you can see Maria and some craters. And if you go up to the really big lenses, like 1,000, and if you can get a loan from the World Bank, a 2,000 millimeter lens, then you're really up to professional standards. But even using those lenses, you have a problem with the contrast or lack of it on the moon. If you photograph the full moon, it's a very bland object. The sun is directly overhead or it's directly beneath behind us on Earth. So there are, the shadows are very, very limited. Now what you want to do, if you take a picture, an orthodox picture of that straight, you get something like this, which is very, very nice, but it's lacking, if you like, snap, crackle and pop. If, however, you underexpose a picture like this and overdevelop, you tend to accentuate the contrast, which I'm sure is preferable. And if we compare the two pictures side by side, I think it's the one on the right that which will win the vote every day. Now, with crescent moons, you've got exactly an opposite problem. You've got intense contrast in the crescent moon. So what you want to do is to ease that contrast. So instead of, as with an orthodox picture like this, where the limb really bleaches out with highlights, what you do is to overexpose and underdevelop, and you ease out those contrasts, and you get a result which I think is much more preferable. And if you look at the two compared, I think the right would have the vote every time. Now, you don't need to keep using these long lenses, because you can get quite useful pictures of the moon with much shorter focal length lenses, say a couple of hundred millimeter. Now, what you can do is overriding, the camera manufacturers have taken a lot of pains to prevent idiots taking double exposures on one frame of picture. Now, you can override that, and if you do, you can, for example, put the moon in the lower left of a frame, and then with a suitable focal length lens, follow it up as it climbs into the sky. Now, you can imagine with a picture of this kind, Patrick, this full moon is very interesting, but it doesn't really tell you much that you don't know. But if you imagine, if we're ever allowed on the south coast to see a full eclipse of the moon again, you can follow this through and see some very interesting developments with the moon. Another point to make, incidentally, is that it depends what sort of colours you get with colour film. It depends very, very much where the moon is relative to the rise. And this is quite low. But if we look at the next picture, which was taken a little bit later, the moon is higher in the sky. So you are, in effect, getting a much cleaner colour representation with the moon. And one final thing I think about the moon to stress, Patrick, is we've seen some pictures here which I think are very, very possible, and I don't like using the word easy because nothing's easy, but quite possible for the starting amateur. But it really is, at the end of the day, fairly demanding, particularly when you get to slow time exposures and you get things like wind buffeting hitting long lenses. It all makes life a little bit difficult, so you really have to apply yourself. It's not a doddle.
No, it certainly isn't, even when you get an eclipse, and we haven't had an eclipse here for some time.
No. Again, you've got a problem here in which you're dealing with a variety of exposures, which can be overcome, because if you bracket, which is a means in which you start off with a relatively slow exposure and go up to one which is much, much shorter, somewhere along the time, a line, depending upon whether it's in the highlight area or in the shadow area, you'll have a picture that suits what you're really after.
Well, the moon, after all, is comparatively straightforward, even though there are many things to be borne in mind, but the planets are a great deal more difficult.
Yes, I think it's fair to say that the planets are really a very demanding task, even for experienced astrophotographers. And it's a question of their size, of course, as we see it from Earth. I've got a couple of pictures here. The first one is of Jupiter, and the second is of Saturn, which were taken on my 8-inch reflector using eyepiece projection, as it's called, with the camera. And these pictures are reproduced at an effective focal length of 35,000 millimeters. Now, that is a mind-boggling focal length to the average photographer.
Yes, indeed.
So does that mean that you need all of that set up to take pictures of the planet? No, it doesn't, because we have these conjunctions, which happily occur quite frequently, which make very, very nice, pleasing, and sometimes, I think, instructive pictures. And we've got some examples here. This is a shot of the crescent moon, which is a favourite addition to this sort of picture. Jupiter and Venus in the lower right, with Mars up towards the top left. Notice here, incidentally, how one can use one's foreground, whether it's lights in the twilight or whether it's trees, although I know you don't like trees, Patrick, because they get in the way. You can use them to make a very pleasant pictorial image. Now, there's another one. Again, well, this one's taken rather more southerly than Langston Harbour. This is Portugal, with the crescent moon and Venus setting in the evening sky. The interesting thing here, I think, is the way in which these fast films give you a very pleasing colour tone or gradation at twilight, whether it's dawn or whether it's in the evening. And we have another picture which illustrates that point, taken just a few days ago. And you see in the lower right there, incidentally, Patrick, this is a data block which my camera prints on the film. It tells me the day on which it was taken with the time, which is very, very useful because I'm rather lazy, so I don't have to make so many notes. This is of Venus coming up in the morning across the top of Scorpius with Antares nicely below and Saturn over on the left side there, which is creating, if you will forgive the expression, a winter triangle for a change. But you can't always, of course, have these very nice twilight skies. You sometimes have to take conjunctions if you want to take them in later in the night. And I took some in December of the Mars and Jupiter conjunctions. This was taken with a 180mm lens with a 2x converter, which in effect doubles that focal length. And you'll see that this lens has managed to discriminate one of the moons of Jupiter, which I think must be Ganymede,
yes, it was,
Patrick.
Yes.
Now, if you switch to a 1,000mm lens, then you see there its greater capability is pulling out very, very clearly two of the moons, which I think was very, very interesting. Now, whether with those sorts of pictures or earlier in the evening or in the morning, you have a problem with the great contrast, the difference of brightness between, say, a Venus and a Saturn or a Mercury. So this is where bracketing becomes important, where you say, for example, start with an exposure of a half a second or a second and go right up through to 10 seconds. And along the way, you should get all of the objects you're interested in, then you can choose whichever is the most important for you. We've got an example here which illustrates this. Venus is up there towards the upper right with Mercury down in the center, a fairly faint point, just hugging the horizon. Now, if you expose for Mercury, Venus is very overexposed. If you do the opposite, well, then it will go the other way. So you have to choose. And here's another example, which is even more, I think, busy, of the crescent moon, which is grossly overexposed here. Venus is up towards its upper right. Mars is further up to the right again. And down towards the left is Saturn. Now, you have an enormous spread there. And it's only you who can really choose which is the result which is going to give you what you want. And I always include in these sorts of pictures, because one so very often includes the crescent moon, I think these delightful pictures one can get of Earthshine, where you just open the lens by a stop or two from what you would normally use, and you can get this delightful effect.
They really are lovely. Now, we've talked about the solar system. Let's go further out, Douglas, and turn now to the stars.
Well, here, of course, you're not worrying about focal length therapy, Patrick. You will be using a 50mm lens for pictures of the constellations, or a wide-angle lens, because you need them with things like constellations like, say, Hydra, and so on, Draco, or even Ursa Major. Your problem is, of course, the rotation of good old Mother Earth, because it's not too long before this will begin to reproduce the stars, not as points of light, but as trails. Now, the film manufacturers have come to our rescue here again, because with these very, very fast films, you don't need enormously long exposures. Now, there is a rough rule of thumb here, which tells you that divide 500 by f, which is f being the focal length of your lens. Now, if you do that, you end up with a figure which is the time in seconds at which you shouldn't see very much star trailing. Now, we've got an example here of a shot I took some time ago of Cassiopeia and Cepheus with Polaris. Now, this was a 20-second exposure with a fixed camera, and I don't think one sees very, very much signs of trailing in a picture of that kind. But, of course, trailing you may want to use, in fact, because it does reveal something about the colours of the stars. Now, we've got an example here. This was about a 4-minute exposure, and you see how very, very clearly one's getting the variety of colours. This is not, I should hasten to say, a scientific objective measurement, but it does give a very, very good approximation, I think.
Well, star trails may look very nice, but very often one doesn't want them. And, of course, you've then got to have your camera driven in some way.
Right.
And if you don't want to buy an expensive equatorial mounting, then you've got to find some kind of, well, I call it a dodge.
Yes. Well, they do exist, Patrick, and have for some years. And we've got one here this evening which has been specially made for us by George Haig of Renfrewshire, who was the inventor of this particular sort of guider. It's and it can be made by any useful handyman, I think. It's basically a piece of around 4x2 wood, which at this end is sawn at an angle which, as far as one can get it, is one's latitude. And for us on the south coast, it's around 51 degrees. Now, fixed to this block of wood are two pieces of obviously much thinner wood, which are hinged at this end. And this, in fact, is the aimed at the pole star. And here is how one gets one's polar alignment, because you can put a little hand mirror here. And the easiest way of lining it up is to get Polaris just about at the end of this line. At this opposite end, one has in effect, a cranking handle, which if you rotate at the speed of one complete revolution a minute, of course we're speeding it up here, you move this end of the outer piece of wood out at a rate which will enable the camera, which is fixed on this mount, to get the stars. And we've got some examples of this here. This is quite a nice example, I think, of Aquila with Delphinus off to the left, which I think is one of the few constellations which really looks like its name. Here's another picture taken with the mount, a 4-minute exposure of Cygnus. And just to underline the fact that one shouldn't denigrate in any way black and white film, because here is a shot taken with the mount over 4 minutes of the upper part of Cygnus, and you can see how easily quite a basic 400 ISO black and white film has pulled out these star clouds in the Milky Way.
Well, the Higgs mounting certainly works, and it is quite easy to make, as you say. Now, we've talked about stars, planets and moon. What else can you recommend as photographic subjects?
Lots of things, Patrick. Meteors, satellites, aurora, you name it. The photographic problems with all of these isn't a particular problem. That they're basically time exposures. It may be 30 seconds with a satellite, maybe perhaps a minute or two. You don't want to go too far because you build up sky fog, particularly from light pollution with meteor pictures. It's a question of where to point the camera. With meteors, it's pretty easy because you will know that there is a particular meteor shower coming from wherever it is, Ursa Major or Perseus or whatever it is. You would point your camera with typically a wide-angle lens to give you the best chance of getting meteors in the appropriate direction, and open the shutter for perhaps a minute at a time and cross your fingers. And we've got some examples here. These were taken, incidentally, by Akira Fuji, who's one of the most talented, a Japanese man who is one of the most talented astrophotographers in the world. Here's a nice example, obviously taken during twilight, although the time exposure was really very long. And another example of a couple of meteors coming out very, very nicely from a radiant. Now, the satellite problem is more acute because you have to know when satellites are coming over. And the newspapers help us with this, because one or two of them publish the times of the brighter satellites, or you can join the BAA satellite section and get the information from there. There you will do broadly the same thing again. Know where the satellite is coming from. Point the camera, and if you can get an idea of what the field of view is, so that you open the shutter before the satellite comes into it and don't close the shutter until after it passes out, you get a very nice and completely continuous trail. And we've got a couple of examples here. This was the space shuttle Columbia on its first trip over the UK back in the autumn of 1983. And you see here that, in fact, I began this exposure when it was in the field of view, because I didn't spot it, because it was in the pollution over Portsmouth, and it went into the Earth's shadow at the top. Second shot of the other side of the Iron Curtain, Salyut 7, which came over home a few weeks ago, and there one got the entire trail. One word of warning to the beginners in particular: don't get misled by a Boeing flying into Gatwick Airport, because I have plenty of these. And here, although it's quite a nice picture of Orion, that trail up in the top right there is an aircraft trail, and don't be misled. And then, of course, the third thing, aurorae. These are really if you can get that far north, these are really the simplest objects in some way, because you see them beginning to develop. You can have your camera ready and ready to go with a time exposure. With the fastest films, a 5 or 10 second exposure is more than adequate, and you can get some results like this. These are a couple I took in Norway some time ago. There's one which is, I think, perfectly adequate, and a second one which I deliberately delayed to get a shot of an aircraft trail apparently moving through the aurora.
Well, there is certainly plenty to photograph, and you've given us a lot to go on. And now we'd like to see some of your astronomical photographs. And I think we must limit these to those taken this year, that's from the start of 1987. So if you'd like to send us some of these, we'll have a special program sometime in the summer, and we'll demonstrate the best ones, and we might even find a prize for those whom we consider really outstanding. But please don't send us originals. We are not going to be able to send them back, I think, because we may be inundated with these, so please send us copies. But we would like to see them, and be prepared for a special program in the summer. And now, finally, our newsletter. It's ready, and if you want it, send your usual stamped addressed envelope to newsletter number 24, The Sky at Night, BBC TV, London W12-8QT. And this particular issue does contain some photographic notes written specially for us by Douglas Arnold. So there we are. Send us your astronomical pictures. And to Douglas and myself, good seeing and good night.